finding fault with them, he said, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." We're living in amazing times. I don't know how anybody can read the newspaper, let alone the Bible, and not realize that the times in which we live are urgent. But the Bible gives us hope. One of my friends postulates the idea, I mentioned this before, that faith is built on hope, but I would submit the opposite. Hope is built on faith. The faith of the world, or so-called faith of the world, may be built on hope, but it ends up hopeless. But the hope of the Christian is built on faith. The great hope of the Christian is that Christ will come back again. How do we know that? By faith in the Bible. And so faith, now abideth faith, hope, love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. So faith is the platform for everything. And this is where, of course, a lot of people preach a humanistic message instead of a God-given gospel. And so I submit that to you. But as you look at the world today, lots of things. Look at some of these headings. Recession looms. Are you prepared? Well, the best way to get recession is to talk about it, isn't it? The end of the Made in China era. Well, I don't think that's a bad thing, quite frankly. But some of the stuff that's made in China leaves a lot to be desired, doesn't it? Marxist Harry Belafonte recommends Obama imprison conservatives. Politics, eh? And if they don't agree with me, put them in jail or whatever. And then another, American tribulation. Can we survive 4 more years of Obama? Well, there we go. That's the headlines of the world. But it's impacting the Christian witness in many ways. And I think we have to realistically face this. Atheists ask Obama to ditch "So help me God," Bible in presidential oath. The pressure's on. Did you hear just this week, last couple of days, that they've brought out a new Bible? Know what it's called? The Queen James Bible. Coming out of San Francisco, deleting all references to homosexuality and lesbianism and all of that. The world is on a slippery slope to nowhere. Or is it on the slippery slope to judgment? Did you know that December the 23rd, something is very significant, is supposed to be going to happen? It's something about Mayan apocalypse. But the problem is, with these stories that are floating around, it's affecting children and pushing them towards suicide among the teenagers, because they don't know how to handle it. We as Christians can be extremely foolish in the way we look at the future and the way we promote the truth that Jesus Christ is coming back again. We don't know the time or the hour. That's why the Bible says we've got to be ready at all times. I wonder if those children and school teachers, 28 dead, including 20 kids, were ready. I wonder if anybody had warned them. I wonder if the gospel had been preached to them. And of course, lots of groups of different persuasion will try to make merchandise of what happened. The gun lobby says that it proves that restriction to guns just doesn't work. Probably because in that particular state there has been some restriction. And yet the other side, they're saying, get rid of the guns, get rid of the guns. It's not the guns that are the problem. It's man in his heart. And the Bible says that things will grow worse and worse. But thank God, the final outlook is bright, because Jesus is coming back again. I've been dealing with a few issues, and as was sort of mentioned in some of the prayers this morning, the emphasis on fellowship. We've been looking at fellowship, but it's in a wider context. And I suppose this is the third in the series on the new covenant. What is the new covenant? I think there's a lot of confusion about it. We tend to take it to ourselves as a church, and I do think that there is a primary and a principal application to the church. But of course, we forget that it relates to a people that some despise. And throughout the generations, throughout world history, of people that have been persecuted. Nonetheless, we are dependent for many of the benefits that have come to us upon the Jewish nation. They have more achievers, even in the natural world, than practically any other nation on earth. That takes some explaining. They have been persecuted more than anybody else on earth. That takes some explaining. Were it not for God, they would have gone under long, long ago. And if it were not for God, they would go under again. But we believe in God. It is wrong for the church to take all the blessings of the new covenant and then leave all the curses of the old covenant to the Jews. We quoted last week something out of our Contending Earnestly for the Faith, and I'd like to quote it again. It's from a man way back in 1688, and his name is Anders Pedersen Kemp. He said, "You heathen Christians, you let yourselves be persuaded by false teachers to believe that the Jews were forever disinherited and rejected by God, and that you were now the rightful Christian Israel to possess the land of Canaan forever." And of course, to apply that to the church about the land promises, you have to spiritualize it into stupidity, really. I believe that all of the blessings of the new covenant do apply to the church, except the one which has to do with the land. And as I said last week, thank you very much, but the Jews can have that one. It's too much of a problem for me. But God says, don't worry, I'll look after them, and I will fulfill my covenant. I think Dave Hunt recently wrote something here. Does Israel have no roots there in history? And he gives some excerpts on September the 24th, a president of Iran informed reporters that Israel has no roots there in history, in the Middle East. Now, a lot of good jokes come to mind at the expense of this clueless man. But seriously, folks, he has at least conveyed an important truth. He recognizes that Israel's historical presence in that world since antiquity matters. Matters enough to deny it. Now, the Bible pictures an Israelite Jewish population and government there starting in the 12th century BC and continuing until the end of the Old Testament history about 800 years later. But how do we know if this is true? Well, archaeology and lots of other things. But there are those who are determined, as was Nazi Germany, to exterminate the Jews, to drive them into the sea. But nonetheless, Israel remains the apple of God's eye. I took up this discussion with a person who is a very strong amillennialist, and he said, no, the church is the apple of God's eye. But, well, the church is described in some marvelous metaphors and images, but it's never actually called the apple of his eye. Israel is the apple of his eye. And the new covenant relates, as did the old covenant, to the Jews. Israel and the Jews. Jeremiah 31:31, "Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will make a new covenant," and notice the specifics, "with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah," the two divisions, northern and southern parts of what we now call Israel. That is repeated verbatim in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 8. "For finding a fault with them," we'll have a look at that in a moment. What is the "them" there? It's certainly not the terms of the old covenant, which Paul, in writing to the Hebrews, refers to. He calls it the first covenant in verse 7. He says, "For finding fault with them." The "them" is obviously the people, not the commandments. There's nothing wrong with the commandments, as we will see. This is very, very important, because the church is moving away from that. And they call it, dub it, legalism and all sorts of things. It's nothing new. It's revived itself throughout history. It's called antinomianism. It's against law. Now, the only way that you are really under grace is if you are living beyond the law or above the law. If you break the law, you are under the law and you are under condemnation. But if you are in Christ, you should not and generally will not break the law. I'm not talking about Australian law. I'm talking about the law of God, the moral law of God, which is called here the first covenant. Verse 6 of Hebrews 8, "But now has he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he," that is Christ, "is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises." Now this relates both to the Abrahamic covenant and to what Jeremiah says, there will be a new covenant. "For if that first covenant," that's not the Abrahamic, that's the Mosaic. "If that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second." What was the fault of that covenant? Not the commands themselves, but man's inability to meet them. That was the problem. "For finding fault with them." Now, there's no plurality in respect of the covenant there, so it cannot refer to the commands. It is referring to the people. "For finding fault with them," he said, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." There it is, repeated verbatim. So, what have we got? Jeremiah 31 is the context. Chapter 30 and verse 24, the last verse, gives us the application. "The fierce anger of the Lord shall not return until he have done it, and until he have performed the intents of his heart. In the latter days you shall consider it." Now that doesn't just principally apply to our day, it applies to any subsequent time. But it basically shows the nature of humans as opposed to the nature of God. God always sees in prospect. Man sees in retrospect. Man is unable to prophesy, no matter how much he tries. God challenges all men to a prophecy contest. And he says, come on, let's be reasonable. Who can declare the end from the beginning? Nobody can do it. Only God can do it. Nostradamus can't do it. He makes some, you know, nice little guesses, most of them predicated upon the Bible. Any ones that are anywhere near the truth are linked to the scripture, But then he gets into imagination and all sorts of things. The same as, you know, the prognosticators that try and get you in and try and get you to give your hand and the tea leaves they read and all this sort of thing. They can't. They're con people. There's nobody who sees in prospect except God. He sees the future. That's why he wrote your name down in the book of life, incidentally, before you made a decision. He didn't do it arbitrarily. Says, okay, I'll put an X on that one and a Y on this one. He did it on the basis of his foreknowledge. All of the foreordained acts of God relate to his foreknowledge in the New Testament. Can't avoid it. God sees in prospect. Man sees in retrospect. Now that doesn't mean that God does not bring his spirit to bear upon individuals. I think he does in a general way, but some more specifically than others. Some are ordained for a particular purpose and have a mission to perform. It may be you. And God sees what will happen down the years. He sees in prospect. Man sees always in retrospect. So what do we have here in Jeremiah 31? Let me run through it very quickly. Because as we'll see in a moment, that really, to get truth, you always have to see it in context. That's the first principle. Secondly, you have to see it in the wider context of the whole of Scripture. Then thirdly, you've got to see it through the prism of Christ. Because inspiration and revelation shines brightest and best through him. But here is the context of this great new covenant. Chapter 31, verses 1 to 14, God will restore Israel. Let me just pick out a few verses. At the same time, saith the Lord, will I be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. Thus saith the Lord, the people which were left of the sword found grace. This is chapter 31, verses 1 and 2. Were left of the sword, found grace in the wilderness. Was grace available in the old covenant? Yes. The word is there frequently. Was fellowship possible in the Old Testament? Yes. The whole idea is there. Even Israel, when I went to cause him to rest, the Lord has appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness, I have drawn you. This is what he does with Israel all the time. And certainly they go off beat and they do wrong things and silly things. There's an Israeli lady that we've been talking to and building a bridge down at Underwood Market. Right now, her husband has gone to Tel Aviv for a wedding. Naturally, she has some fears. Let's pause and pray. I've given them some of our literature, and she said her husband was very impressed with it. The first message, well, not this current CETF, but the previous one, where we summarized Paul Wilkinson's take on Israel and her place in history. Let's pray that God will save them. Lord, I pray right now that you will send your Holy Spirit of conviction to that man in Tel Aviv and maybe bring some Messianic Jew across his path, that he will come to know you and lead his wife and family into the sure knowledge of Jesus, Messiah, for the glory of your great and eternal name. God will restore Israel. Verse 8, behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the coasts of the earth, and with them that them, the blind and the lame and the woman with child and her that travaileth with child together, a great company shall return hither. Hear the word of the Lord, verse 10. O ye nations, and declare it in the isles afar off, and say, he that scattered Israel will gather him and keep him as a shepherd doth his flock. Why? Because Israel is the apple of God's eye. For the Lord hath redeemed Jacob and ransomed him from the hand of him that was stronger than he. He has done it throughout history. And my dear friend, you can rest assured that he will do it again. So God will restore Israel, verses 1 to 14. Go right through it. But Christ is central. In my Bible, my King James Version, and I notice now somehow, even in the online Bible, you get different words. It's supposed to be King James, but when I check it against the one I've got, it's slightly different. They put said instead of Seth. Now, Seth is an old English word, but it's not the equivalent of said. It's the equivalent of says, S-A-Y-S. So if they're going to change it, why put it in the past? Why not put it in the present? They do it with Jeremiah 31:31 and also Hebrews 8:8. This is why we've got to be so very, very careful. But here in my Bible, right against verse 15, it has a cross. And it, by the crosses, as you go through, it's sort of saying this is messianic. Verse 15 says, thus saith the Lord, a voice shall be heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping, Rachel weeping for her children, refused to be comforted for her children because they were not. When was that fulfilled? At the time of, yeah, Herod, that's right. Matthew chapter 2, verse 18, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, when Herod decreed the slaughter of all the infants 2 years old and under, in order, as he thought, to get rid of the Messiah. Well, they've tried, haven't they? They didn't succeed, they won't succeed, they can't succeed, because our God reigns eternally. But Christ is central, always central, to the whole message. So in relating to Israel and end times and all of this, and next week, well, not next week, because we've got a Christmas theme next week, but my next message, and probably be the final of this, I'm going to show that the millennium is also part of the new covenant. I won't have time to get onto that today. So here's the context still of Jeremiah 31, where it says he's going to make a new covenant. Verses 31 to 40 deals with this new covenant. Verse 31, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break. So really the covenant predates, even the old covenant, predates Sinai. The terms of the covenant are at Sinai, the commands. That's why I take the view, and I don't mind if people disagree with me. God reserves the right to bless the man who disagrees with me. But I always think that he'll be more blessed if he agrees with me. I take the view that the church did not start on the day of Pentecost. Now, the reason we try to put it into that context is simply because we think, as humans do, systematically. But I don't think God thinks systematically. And the relation of Pentecost in respect of the 50 days and from Passover and so on, and the fact that it relates to the time when the Sinai was given, which in their thinking sort of parallels the idea of Israel becoming a nation and now the church is established. Well, I think the Bible always interprets itself not according to our systematized thinking, but rather according to its statements. And the Bible shows, from my perspective anyway, that we are born again, not by the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we are born again on the basis of the resurrection. And Jesus illustrated it when he breathed on his disciples on that day of the resurrection and said, "Receive Holy Spirit." I think, anyway, that's regeneration. So regeneration is before. Predates. Yeah, that's it. That's reasonably good. Yeah, not the one I was thinking of, anyway. But but it is before the baptism of the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit enters us. So all Christians, they don't become Christians unless the Holy Spirit gets into them. And he gets there by the energizing work of the Scriptures. You are born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which lives and abideth forever. And Peter said that. He also said that it was by the resurrection. So that's how I take it. Now, what happened on Pentecost was the church was made militant. It was energized and commissioned and thrust out. That's why when the disciples said, "Will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" Now, Jesus did not say, "You've got it all wrong." That's what the amillennialists and many people tried to say that he said. Jesus simply said, "You are not to know the timing." That's all he said. Because that is in his province. The most important thing for you is to know that you will receive power, dunamis, after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my martyrs, you will be my witnesses, here, there, and everywhere, unto the ends of the earth. So, here, back again to the covenant. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers, in the day that I took them by the hand, they were already redeemed, to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts. Now, of course, we can parallel that and say, yeah, that's what happens when we become Christians. He writes his law in our heart. Yeah, sure, no problem. That is true. But that's not the full truth. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts and will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor. Where does that fit? Do we stop evangelizing? Don't think you will ever, David, will you? Do we ever arrive at a point where we say, I don't have to tell you because God has written the law in your heart? No. When will this happen? The millennium. That's the only possibility. That, among other reasons, is why I believe there must be a millennium. Other reason is that it's the only form of government that has never been tried in the world. Now, somebody misunderstood me when I made this statement before, but I think I'm right, and so I'll make it again. You can find every form of government as being tried. You've got democracy. You've got theocracy. You've got a form of dictatorship. But the one thing that has never been tried is an absolute dictatorship by a benign, true dictator. Who is he? There's only one. God Almighty. When he will rule the nations with a rod of iron. When his will be done. That has to be tried. Because there's a principle in Romans, as far as I can understand, that every mouth has to be silenced. Even Richard Dawkins' mouth has to be silenced. Men have done pretty good at it. But I tell you, when he stands before God Almighty, unless he repents, and if he does, praise God, and we've been praying for him, that he will find salvation, things will be vastly changed. He had a Christian background, obviously. But he's departed like so many. But every voice will be silenced. And God will say, okay, I've proved throughout history that there is no other way but the voluntary submission of the human will to my way through my Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Even the absolute dictatorship only works as long as the rod of iron is there. But when it's taken away, Satan is released, and what happens? The whole of the nations rebel again against God. Think of that, going through all of that. And they rebel against God. The millennium's here, but I don't want to get onto that yet. I've only got less than half an hour to go. I will put my law in their inward parts, write it in their hearts, will be their God, and they shall be my people, and they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord, and I will forgive their iniquity and will remember their sin no more. All right. The new covenant. There's another term used, which was used this morning as we came around the table of the Lord. It's the term New Testament. Hebrews 8:8 says, for finding fault with them, he said, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Matthew 26:28 says, for this is my blood of the New Testament. Two different English words which signify different things. But of course, in the Greek, they are identical. They are exactly the same. And it's the Greek that we have to make reference to, although I think we can draw on the English to signify a slight difference here. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. The word covenant is diatheke, and it appears 20 times in the English version. 13 times it is translated testament in the New Testament. Testament, same word, and obviously the same number of times as we've referred. What does it mean? It means a disposition or an arrangement of any sort which one wishes to be valid. The last disposition which one makes of his earthly possessions after his death, a testament or will. It's a compact, a covenant, a testament. There's an illustration of God's covenant with Noah. God says in Genesis 9:13, I will set my bow in the heavens. Now, Noah didn't have any part to play in that. And you didn't either. Some people say a covenant has to involve the action of two people. No. Two people or two groups or whatever have to be involved. But some of the covenants of God are just absolutely from his perspective only. This is one of them. He set his bow in the clouds. What was the promise? I won't destroy the world again by a flood. Despite all of the tsunamis and all of the terrible things that are going on in Samoa and around the world, God will not destroy the world by a flood. It's reserved for fire. Judgment is coming. But it's by fire, not by flood. So the New Covenant and the New Testament, we can use it interchangeably, except there's this point. The covenant conveys the idea of a contract, an agreement. The testament conveys the idea of an action by a person who is going to death. He makes a will. Thank God he did. And he made it of his own account. And there in that upper room, when they were all Jews, from the Abrahamic covenant on, all of the covenants that God made were with Israel, with a Jewish people. They were all Jews in the upper room. I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of... We are recipients. We are blessed. We get the blessing. No doubt. No doubt about that. Please don't think I'm saying that doesn't happen. But it's with Israel. The old is called the vanishing covenant. Hebrews 8:13, and in that he says a new covenant. He has made the first old. Now that which decays and waxes old is ready to vanish away. It hasn't vanished away yet. You're right, Lance. No matter all the arguments and the things that people say, and we've had one or two, haven't we, as a result of your article on the new prince, fresh prince in Singapore, with his mega church, he is preaching a false message, as is Hillsong, as is many, many mega churches. They confuse the idea of popularity being the measure instead of truth being the measure. You break the law and you will suffer as a result. The old is vanishing away. It's not vanished yet. It's still there. You see, the whole thing is based on human failure. Let's go back to Hebrews 8 and verse 8 again, where it says, "For finding fault with them." Now, it cannot possibly be with... He would have said it if he was talking about the law. Or he would have referred to the Ten Commandments if he was using them in reference to that. He's referring to the people. "For finding fault with them," he said, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." So the old is vanishing away. Not vanished yet. It's all, the weakness of it relates to human failure and frailty. Romans 7:14. Paul takes this himself further. He says, "For we know that the law is spiritual." Nothing wrong with the law. "But I am carnal." Not "I was carnal." I am carnal. The carnality of the human flesh and the human heart remains. It's never eradicated. It's there. That is why all true Holy Ghost convicting preaching will mention sin and will mention repentance. It has to be. You look at the great revivals of history and you'll find that always there was much mention about sin under the power of the Holy Ghost until people were convicted and they fell on their faces, cried out to God for forgiveness. Those two things must be present. It's not present in most of the mega churches today. So what are they doing? They are filling their buildings with sinners on the way to hell. And unfortunately, they help them on that way. And as Frank was saying, they'll do anything to get the people in. Games and gimmicks and anything. They don't know how to preach. Now, it wouldn't be so bad if they got all those people there and they allowed somebody to come in to really preach the gospel. Then there might be some justification in the idea of being relevant for a purpose. but it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. Romans 7:18, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwells no good thing, for to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I don't know how to do it. This is the struggle. This is the struggle for the person outside of the gospel, and this is the struggle for the person inside of the church. How do I do it? How do I do it? Thank God, Paul doesn't leave us in a dilemma. Chapter 7, verse 24 to 25, he takes us deeper and he says, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? This body that I keep dragging around, that is destroying me, that is stifling me, that is killing me, that is impairing my progress. How can I deal with it? And he doesn't leave us there. He says, I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. And it's that sin that has to be constantly addressed. Two mountains, Mount Sinai, Mount Zion. Mount Sinai was reflected in also two other mountains, which I didn't intend to talk about, but they're there. One is called Mount Ebal, which was the Mount of Curse, and the other was Mount Gerizim, which was the Mount of Blessing. If you do a geographic study of the two, you'll find that Mount Ebal is much higher than Mount Gerizim. Because under the old, the curse was predominant. Mount Gerizim was there nonetheless, the Mount of Blessing. But the two mounts that we are contrasted in the Bible, in the New Testament, is Mount Sinai and Mount Zion. We used to sing a song, didn't we? Not to Sinai, not to Sinai. Do you remember it? Anybody remember it? Oh, Jeff, where were you living way back then? Of course, you weren't living way back then. Wait. Come on then, will you sing it with me? Not to Sinai, not to Sinai, but to Zion I've arrived. Not a broken law, not a broken law, but a Savior who's alive. That's enough. We will talk of him and his wondrous ways. Not to Sinai, not to Sinai, but to Zion is alive. Great. And these are the two mountains that are mentioned. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. They're mentioned in the Bible. Scripture, remember this, Scripture always interprets Scripture. So when you come to this after Romans 7, which says, oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from the body of this death? Then he says, I thank God through Jesus Christ my Lord. So then, with the mind I will serve the law, but with my flesh, the law of sin. What is he saying? And then he comes to the next great statement, Romans 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ. Lance, I think Joseph, whatever his name is, Prince, has a point, but he goes too far. There are Christians who live under condemnation. And they live under condemnation because they have not realized their freedom in Christ. We are not justified in Christ on the basis of us not committing sin. We are justified in Christ on the basis of our coming to him and our being justified by him. And then, at that point, there is no condemnation. So our starting point is no condemnation. There is no condemnation to those in Christ. I preached about this some time ago. I don't know where you get the tape, but it's there somewhere. That is our starting point. Now, having started there, you have to go on through to verse 4, where it talks about not walking after the flesh, but after the Spirit. If we come and start at the point of no condemnation, and then we become antinomian, we become careless about the requirements of the Bible. There are so many commands in the New Testament that it's impossible to overlook them. Commands about keeping yourself pure. Commands about not continuing in sin. Commands about the danger of submitting your thoughts and your living to the flesh. It will destroy you. Galatians tells us that if we sow to the flesh, we will of the flesh reap corruption. But if we sow to the Spirit, we will of the Spirit reap life everlasting. So, certainly, that is my starting point. There's no condemnation. There's no condemnation. I'm not condemned. When the devil comes and whispers his words to us, and particularly as people get older, some people, they feel this. They feel, if only I'd done this, or if only I'd done that. Listen, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ. If only I'd done this, but if you would have done that, you don't know what the consequences of that would have been. And the devil gets you on a runabout, you know, a roundabout. So there's no condemnation. Tell him he's a liar, that you are in Christ and there's no condemnation. But don't then go out and do what you want to do and sin and so on. That will bring you into condemnation. Rightly. So, Romans 8 verse 1 has to be taken in conjunction with Romans 8 verse 4. I always ask three questions when I'm not certain about something in the Bible. First of all, what does the context display? Secondly, what does all of Scripture convey? Thirdly, what does Christ, the center of the gospel, portray? Those three questions will always resolve the issue. That's why the modern message of Joseph Prince, even though he's popular, I didn't know how popular he was until Lance wrote that article. And then I walked into Koorong and his books are everywhere. It's a false message. It does not address the basic requirement of humankind, which is to find a resolution to sin. Never calls for repentance. Always God wants to bless you. Prosperity. That's why he gets openings at places like Hillsong and others, because they are birds of a feather who flock together. And sadly, though it is, they are taking countless thousands down the road to hell. Because it's not the message of the gospel. The message of the gospel starts in the gospel and runs right through all of the gospels, the Acts of the Apostles, all of the epistles, even into the book of the Revelation, where you finally have the bride and the Spirit saying, come. The whole message is repent. Repent of your sins. You see, Paul, I think, was one of the greatest Christians who ever lived. How did he describe himself? He said, I am the greatest of sinners. People say, when you're a Christian, you shouldn't say that you're a sinner. Well, tell that to the Apostle Paul. He didn't say, I was the greatest of sinners. He says, I am the greatest of sinners. Because in the light of what Jesus Christ has done for him, he feels no matter what he has done, it's a great weight of sin upon him. And so the only answer is Christ. Christ alone. What does the context display? What does all of Scripture convey? What does Christ, the center of the gospel, portray? Hebrews 12, 18. For we are not come to the mount that might be touched. That's Sinai. But we come to Zion. And we come to the general assembly of the firstborn As has been rightly said, Christ is the firstborn in the sense of the church. That is, he's the leader, he's the fire leader, he's the captain. He is the only begotten in a unique sense. Don't confuse the two ideas. He is the only begotten Son of God in the sense that he is unique. Nobody else is like him. Now, the word begotten doesn't mean the same as we understand the term in human terms. He's the only begotten Son of God, part of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. He is the firstborn of many brethren, and we are brought into his assembly. Hebrews 12:24, we're brought to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. So Hebrews 12:25 says, see that you do not refuse him. See, it's there. You can't get away from it. See that you do not refuse him. He's talking to Christians. See that you do not refuse him that spoke on earth. Much more shall we not escape. We won't escape if we turn away from him who speaks in heaven. The church is God's scheme of things. It's his plan. It's his purpose. I was glad when our brother brought that interpretation this morning. It was bang on the things that were coming to me. But my thought was maybe more in light with my own message even, which would need to be come out, that God knows everything. God plans everything. He purposes everything. That's why you just can't purpose something for yourself. You've got to know what his purpose is. That's why Paul prayed for the Ephesian Christians. He said that you may know what is the hope of his calling, not your own calling, but his calling. He put his hand on you and called you. What was the hope of that? What was the plan? What is your destiny? Your destiny is wrapped up in him. It's not something I'll plan, I'll purpose. You know, it's not that. It's rather, he has a plan. He has a purpose. And his overarching purpose is involved, not just with Israel, though it does involve Israel. It's involved with the church. Mark 14, verse 44, and he said to them, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. We've done it this morning. Luke 22:20, likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this covenant, this cup is the new testament in my blood, which is shed for you. 1 Corinthians 11:25, after the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the new testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. Abel's blood, the offering that he brought, bespoke the truth that for sin to be atoned, it would require a blood offering as distinct from what Cain brought. But it wasn't the blood of the animal that Abel brought. It's the precious blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hebrews 9:15, and for this cause, he is the mediator, he is the umpire of the New Testament, that by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the First Testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. So back to the question, when did the church really start? Well, I think you have to go back to the time of Abraham, personally. We are redeemed from before, even before that. We are redeemed from before the foundation of the earth. This is why the significance of fellowship carries through in both testaments, the New Testament and the Old Testament. 2 Corinthians 3:6. Who has made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Hebrews 2:9, the focus. What do we see? But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for everyone. Ephesians 3, 10 to 11. Back where we were, what is the church? What is the church? We are participants, we are beneficiaries of the new covenant. Yes. Why did God make man? For fellowship? No. He already had fellowship, far greater than the fellowship he could ever have with man. Fellowship of the Trinity, the fellowship of angels. Why did he make man? Ephesians tells us to the intent. Yeah, we're back to what we said before, that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church, through the church, the much varied wisdom of God according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. The purpose without beginning and without end. Remember a diamond? Beautiful. Probably the most valuable one in the world. But it's got no worth. Absolutely no worth. Put it in a dark room and it's useless. What's the glory of that crown? What's the glory of the diamond? It's the beauty of light as it shines upon it. To the intent that now unto the principalities and the powers might be known by the church, the manifold, the great variety of God's wisdom through the church. And Israel has to come the same way. God's not going to deal ultimately with regard to judgment with Israel differently from the church. We've all got to come through Christ. That diamond, the beauty of it, the texture of it, the value of it was established with a pressure of hundreds and thousands of years of earth upon it. A little bit of carbon from here and another little bit from there. A little bit from Wales and a little bit from Australia and a little bit from America and a little bit from Israel and a little bit from here and a little bit from there, Scotland and all of the places, even England, yes, yes, and put together, crushed, put through the pressure of the cross. And the value of it is the value of him, his light shining upon it. That's why our constant cry should be to be like Jesus. Make us more like Jesus. Because he's the only valuable person in all the world. But he says, I'll make you worth something as well. But it won't be your own worth. It will be my worth. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray that you will help us to be more like Jesus. We pray that you will help us to see the truth of the gospel. We pray that we will never deviate from it. We pray that we will preach it without fear or favor for the glory of your name. And we pray that you will rescue people from the darkness of sin, both inside and outside of the church. Until there will be a manifestation of your glory, a reflection of your beauty through your people for the glory of your name. We pray that you will help us as we go out this week, that we may share with others that they too may come to know Christ, whom to know is life eternal. Thank you now in Jesus' name. Amen.